Ah. Nothing puts a smile on my face like a sassy old rig like this. Anyways, welcome back to Diesel Creek. My name's Matt, of course. This is my 1980 Autocar Constructor that I bought probably 6 or 7 months ago now and really haven't touched. I actually bought this truck because a whole bunch of viewers kept sending it to me in emails saying, hey, you really need this truck. And I just kept trying to say, nope, resist the urge. Then my wife walked in the room and saw me looking at it and said, hey, that's a pretty cool looking truck. You should probably own that. I don't know how I got so lucky. Couple hour drive and I think $7,000 later, here she is. Now I did one video on this truck previously. The link is down in the description. It wasn't a whole lot of video, just basically an overview of the truck. And today we're actually gonna get into start working on this thing so we can get it on the road and pulling some equipment, which is why I bought it. I really haven't gotten to work on this truck whatsoever yet. So today we're gonna try to start getting into this thing and seeing what all we need to do to put it on the road. I gotta mount a fifth wheel plate. We gotta do a complete service on this truck and probably a whole bunch of other little miscellaneous stuff. The goal with this truck is to turn it into a tractor so that I can pull my lowboy trailer with it and I can actually move around some of the bigger iron that I've got now and take it out to jobs and actually make some money with it rather than just seeing it sit here and get rusty. All right, well, one of the first things I wanna do on this truck is cut off these frame extensions because we're not gonna need them anymore. These nuts are pretty darn rusted over, so we'll try the impact, but I have no idea if it's gonna work. Watch your ears. Nice. This 3/4 Milwaukee is an absolute beast. All right, so to cut this frame rail off, I'm gonna use this the skill saw. Now, everybody always asks me 1,000 questions about this thing every time it's on an episode, but this is a skill worm drive. I think they call this the Outlaw. I don't know. The link to my Amazon store is down in the description and these things are in it. So this thing's been a beast. It cuts through steel like this, like nobody's business, but it is different than a typical wood saw. It spins much slower, so it cuts metal better. Well, we finally got those rails cut off of there, and I wasn't really thinking double frame plus that piece of 3/8 on there means that we were cutting through 15/16 worth of steel, so nearly an inch worth of steel. And plus, I should have just sacrificed an inch of frame and moved up an inch, because I cut directly through the actual weld bead, which is super hard, and that saw, it did it, but the blade was already pretty dull when I started. So by the end of it there, I just finished it off the grinder, because it was slow going. With a fresh blade, that saw rips right through 1-inch plate. That's not really a problem, but yeah, the blade's pretty pooched. Anyway, moving on. Well, I got to pull the air cleaner apart here to get the numbers off the filters and see if we even need to replace them. I've never had this apart here, so let's see how bad they are. I already got this band loose, but the cap's still pretty stuck on here. See what I mean? Good gravy. There you go, it's coming now. Oh yeah, it's got some dust in it. Two four of 2000. Wow. 22-year-old air filter. I'm sure I've changed older, but this is the oldest dated one that I can remember. Miles of threads. She is pretty dusty. Yeah, you know what? It looks pretty good inside. But it's 22 years old. I'm just going to go ahead and replace it. First things first here, to start this old beast, we have literally been hot wiring it. The guy I bought it from didn't have the key. This is how he was starting it. So I went and picked up a new ignition switch, and we can actually start this thing with a key now rather than a piece of wire. That'll be nice. So here's our new ignition switch. I believe these are all wired the same, you know, as far as the studs. This one does not have the center stud. But that's because this is just an off and on switch, and then you have the push button up here, which actually turns the engine over. This one could be wired to do it with the key. You know, you've got off position, run position, and then the cranking position. So we just won't use that center stud, that's all. So pretty self-explanatory. We're just taking wires off and putting them back on. Alright, there we go. I'm hoping this is something we don't have to fix. Sometimes these starters, when they're just sitting around, the contacts get dirty. But after you run them a few times, they start working. When you press that start button on the dash there, it is supposed to engage that solenoid right there on the side of the starter. Now, I have been having trouble since I got the truck. When stuff like this sits, the points and contacts in there get corroded, and they don't like to make good connection or slide freely, and that leads to the trouble that we're having. So I've had the exact same trouble with the Cat 977 loader, if you've seen those videos. But basically, we just have to pull that little box off the side of the starter, open it up, clean it up, and reassemble it, and it should, quote-unquote, should work. This solenoid doesn't look incredibly difficult to get out of there, but it certainly doesn't look like a picnic either, so not a lot of room in here to work. I'll see if I can set you guys up on a time lapse while I struggle and wiggle about and try to get this thing out of here.
Well, I ended up pulling the entire starter out, which, let me tell you, was a special treat. This big sucker right here probably weighs about 100 pounds. I mean, this thing is heavy. And I'll remind you that the hole we were working in there is not exactly conducive to lifting that thing out. You can't really get over top of it. You can't get your hands in there to get a good hold of it and then lift it out. So it was fun. I didn't bother to record it because there was lots of cussing, but it is out. And as I said before I removed the starter, I was thinking I could just slide this solenoid off the actual starter motor like my Cat 977, but it doesn't appear that that's the case. I could not get it free. I did have it loose. You know, it's... I don't know what the deal is there. We're going to get into this thing and see if we can't find any issues. I don't think there's any serious issues. The starter itself spins over just fine. It's just this solenoid that's giving us issues. There's the ID tag on the starter too, if we have any starter nerds in the crowd. Anywho, I think we just gotta pull that nut off right there, and that solenoid should just slide out. So if you're not familiar with these starters like this, I call them double acting starters. I don't know what the proper term really is, but you have power coming into one side of your solenoid and power out, obviously, and it goes down into the actual starter on this pole back here. When you push the push button in the cab, it sends trigger voltage down here to this solenoid, which takes the voltage from the power in. It uses that to slam a plunger down in here, and when the plunger runs down, it forces the Bendix out. So it forces the Bendix into the flywheel, and then as the plunger runs down all the way, the plunger also becomes the contactor, which sends voltage out the other post and down into the starter, spinning the starter over. So double acting, or at least that's what I call them. So basically what the trouble is with this one is the contacts inside of here obviously have to be gummed up or dirty or worn or something. So all right, well, after giving it some thought, something I do on occasion, I realized I don't even have to take this thing off of here. Oh yeah. All right, so the way this works is it's mounted up like this, you know, inside of there, and this thing slides in and out off of a magnet in the solenoid. So when you press the start button, this is supposed to slam down here and cause contact between these two points right here, spinning the starter. Now you can see this one's had some pretty heavy arc out sparts, but it's not corroded. It should be making good contact. It's still nice and clean copper there. Same for this side. Did you guys just see that spring get sucked away? Now would you believe that I saw where it landed? That was amazing. What luck, huh? Well, those contacts are about as clean as they could be. I am going to put this together and try to bench test it before we put it completely back together, since it was such a treat to get it in there. All right, we should be ready to bench test this thing here. All I have to do is take power from this terminal and touch it to this stud, and it should go. Well, of course, it's working now. Well, we went through all that aggravation with this starter. Let's see if this thing's actually going to start now. It better. Good sound.
With me, and we'll see a world of OSHA violations. Alright, so one of our air leaks that we have going on here is out of this thing. I think this is called a relay. I don't know that much about air systems. I understand about slack adjusters and spring canisters and stuff, but I really don't know any of this kind of stuff. So it's leaking out of like a blow-off vent or something over here, or I don't know what the heck this part of it is. So usually what I do when I don't understand something or don't know what it is I just take it apart and figure it out and see exactly what it is and how it works. So we got some sort of a diaphragm going on here. Some sort of a plunger. So this deal here, kind of like a plunger thing, and it's pretty dirty in here, so
thinking maybe that's all our issue is something's over here in this section, whatever this is on the side here, and could be a piece of dirt hanging something open. So I'm just gonna keep ripping and tearing and clean it all out, and hopefully it works. There we go. I'll take this thing all apart here, I guess, and try to figure this thing out. Oh yeah, a little bit of corrosion going on in there. And you can see the seal here got some sort of damage to it. Well, I don't know that we can just clean this up and fix it. I think that that seal is probably gonna need replaced. And I don't know if you can just buy the seals. You probably have to just buy a whole new sealed unit. They don't seem to make anything rebuildable anymore.
All right, well, I decided to go ahead and clean this thing up because Napa can't find a seal kit for this model. You know, I could probably find a different model to upgrade this thing from to a newer part number, but they're like $100. I don't know. It didn't take me very long. I just cleaned this thing up a bit. Looks nice inside now. The seal here is still not perfect, but I'm gonna put a little bit of some clear grease on it. And yeah, hopefully this works. All right, well, I got the air relay put back in here, and I had to replace these couple air lines here. They were pretty terrible condition, so got some nice new ones on there, and I have to get one special fitting yet to connect to this thing yet. So the new hose has a different end, so I have to get a different fitting for this guy, but that should be pretty much done. And after we're done with our engine service here, we're gonna be able to fire this thing back up and see if this thing leaks anymore. This fuel filter froze up on me a couple times over the winter, so I know it's got some water in it. Oh man, yeah, you can smell this fuel has seen better days. Let's see if there's any nasties come out of this fuel filter here. Oh yeah. See all those chunks that float out of here? Oh man, yep, she was clogged up. This is not a fun place to get a fuel filter into. I know somebody's probably telling me in the comments to get it from underneath, but the way the air lines are underneath, I don't think you could fish it up through there either. Plus, it's directly over top of the axle, so that's in the way as well. Well, there we go. Fuel filter changed.
like that fuel filter actually helped quite a bit. The throttle response is better now, so I'm just going to go ahead and throw some ATF in the fuel tank here. ATF will help clean and lubricate these injectors. This truck has sat a lot of its life. It's a 1980 with 26,000 miles on it, so...
Holy crap. Oh, that's not good.
This oil plug does not want to come out. So I'm going to heat the plug, let it cool down here. Might have to do this a couple times before we can get this thing to come out. It's a steel plug in a aluminum oil pan, so iron and aluminum oxidize and make it just about impossible to break loose sometimes.
Thank goodness. Oh man. I was literally just hanging off of that wrench to make that happen. Whew. This is gonna make a mess because it's gonna drain down onto this belly pan first and then it's gonna go into my catch pan here. I guess there's just no way around making a mess with it. Hoping the camera doesn't get squirted here. No way around this, it's gonna be a mess. The skid plate is not easy to remove. There's a bunch of bolts and yeah, it's just not gonna happen. The good news is it's only making a mess on the skid plate. Draining down into the pan nicely. And the oil is dark, but it looks good. It doesn't look like there's any contaminants in it. I don't see any metal flake or anything so far. All right, well, this truck has two oil filters, one of which is this spin-on up here. And I don't think this is original. I think somebody added this. But I could be wrong. Any of you guys that really know auto car trucks, let me know. The second oil filter is over here in this housing on the side of the engine. New filter. That side goes towards the engine. Reinstall our cap. All right, now of course for engine oil, we're gonna use Shell Rotella T5.
This is their synthetic blend oil, so this stuff has a different additive pack in it compared to the conventional oil. That I'm not a petrochemical engineer by any means, but I know this stuff's got the good stuff in it that's good for these old engines. Another perk to using the semi-synthetic blend stuff is that you're supposed to be able to get much longer oil change intervals. You're supposed to be able to get longer service life between oil changes using this semi-synthetic too. So since this vehicle is new to me, I think at some point I'm actually going to send out some oil samples and have some sampling done from this engine to make sure we don't have any critical components going out of it. But since it's only got 26,000 miles on it, I don't think we're going to have any issues. But that's also another great reason to stick with good oil and not chance anything. All right. Should be ready to fire this thing back up. The next item on our list here for the service is gear oils. Now, there are several things on this truck that take gear oil. One of them is the transmission there. And on the bottom of the transmission, there's a PTO. And the PTO seal is leaking oil pretty darn good. So we're gonna have to drop that shaft, take a look at that. The other areas that take gear oil on this truck, the transmission, of course, holds gear oil. This little housing here that looks like a gearbox that runs the PTO for the winch, that guy should have gear oil in it. The deep reduction gearbox on the front of the axle here, that should have gear oil in it, as well as both pumpkins on both rear ends here. So probably going to go through about 10 gallon of 90 weight at least, and yeah, hopefully everything looks good when we drain it. And I cannot wait until I have a concrete floor to work on. See, this thing's been leaking pretty good. All right. Now that the pan's in place, I gotta drain the transmission before we can even think about pulling that seal. Well, just to give you the lay of the land here, this unit up here is actually the transmission and the drain plug for the transmission right there. But the way this PTO is configured directly on the bottom of the transmission means that that drain plug is no longer our lowest point. We should be able to drain everything out through the PTO, but I don't actually see a drain plug on it anywhere. So I'm just going to start by pulling one of these bolts out of this cover, because I'm not looking to have a repeat of what happened when I drained Fat Alice's transmission. Like, it's going to be packed. Woo! Good Lord.
Wowzers.
Right. Well, that worked. Got my impact nice and oily, but it worked. So we're gonna let that drain. It's gonna take a while since we're only using one bolt. I might pull out one more just to try to speed things up, but yeah, you see the picture here. Well, here we are like an hour and a half later. I'm gonna stick this bolt back in here so we don't lose it, but all the oil is drained
Now we should be able to drop this drive shaft. Well, this is not the main drive shaft. This is just the PTO drive shaft. Anyway, we can drop that and take the yoke off and should be able to pull that seal out. Watch your ears. Ugh. Don't force it. Get a bigger hammer. There ain't no way to get a good swing under here. There we go. Holy crap. I had to use a 4-foot bar. All right, I actually had to take the socket and put it in the lathe and turn it down to fit inside of this yoke. But hopefully the thing comes off of here now and doesn't break my socket. I forgot I need an adapter. Son of a diddly. Beautiful. There's our yoke. I can try to get this seal out of here. There we go. Let's see if we can find some numbers on this bad boy.
All right, well, the last thing that we really need to do mechanically on that truck is to put the PTO output shaft seal back in and reinstall the drive shaft. Now, I've pulled this drive shaft out because I think I mentioned when I removed it, when I removed the seal yoke, that slider right there is no longer sliding. She no slide no more. It's seized up tighter than a drum. So we'll see if we can't do something about that. Unreal. I got a lot of pressure on that thing. It's not wanting to move. Prepared to break something to do this.
Well, that was absolutely ridiculous. that machine was dragging this machine, even with wheel chocks, and that thing still didn't budge. So I don't know. I think that's going to be a future episode. I don't have time to mess with that thing right now. All that does is run the winch, and we don't need the winch for what we're doing here. Got our new PTO seal here. Let's get this thing installed. So, make sure there's no dirt around here. We're just gonna start it in by hand with the hammer. Just get started. Then we use a big socket here as a seal driver and knock her home. Alright, now, if you remember, the original seal was completely flush with this flange right here, and I intentionally set it back in there, probably almost a quarter inch. I did that because you can see where the seal used to ride on this yoke right here, and it's actually created a wear ridge. The rubber seals will actually eat the metal over time, and that's why it was leaking. So, and setting that seal back further in there, we're gonna get onto a nice fresh piece of metal there. It should slide right together. It should slide right together. Slide right together! There we go. That slid right together. Alright, with that PTO yoke back in place, we are ready to refill the transmission. I believe that guy right there is the fill level plug. Alright, let's get our bucket pump and start pumping. All right, transmission's full. We can start this pig up. So with the system pressurized, sitting here listening to this relay valve now, I can still hear it is leaking just a little bit, but substantially better than what it was before we cleaned it out. So I'd say that's mission somewhat accomplished. I'll probably end up buying a seal kit. I found one online. I'm gonna buy a seal kit and rebuild this thing. All right, well, I do regret to inform you that I gotta cut the video off there because I just couldn't get this thing done in time. I have been on this thing solid all week, all day, every day, working until like 10, 11 o'clock at night, and this close. So I gotta cut this video in half. The next half, we are gonna have this thing absolutely on the road. We're gonna hook up to the low boy trailer, and we're gonna put a piece of equipment on it and pull it somewhere. I don't know where, but we're gonna do something. If you guys like this video and you want to see more videos on the auto car, don't forget to hit that thumbs up button. It really lets me know that I'm on the right kind of content that you guys want to see. And it really helps out the channel and helps me keep producing more videos.
If you're not already, of course, you're going to want to make sure that you're subscribed as well, because there's going to be a lot more videos coming with this truck in it. Not to mention, I still have the 57 auto car over here as well that we're going to be working on again here once we get the shop built. The shop is the key to getting that one done, because with the amount and the level of work that needs to happen on that truck, there's just no way you can do it out here kind of in the elements. We need a proper shop setting to really get that thing back into shape. Last but certainly not least, if you want to help support the channel and make yourself one heck of a fashion statement in the process, don't forget to head over to dieselcreek.com. There's a link down in the description. Pick yourself up a hat, a t-shirt, a beer koozie, some stickers, whatever it is. You'll be helping support the channel and you'll be doing it in style. But that's all I've got for today. As always, guys, thank you for watching, and I will see you on the next one. Later!